Please stand. Behold, the life-giving cross upon which was hung the salvation of the world. Behold, the life-giving cross, upon which was hung the salvation of the world.
O come, let us worship him.
Behold, the life-giving cross, upon which was hung the salvation of the world.
O come,
in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And this is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and the people loved the darkness rather than the light, because their works were evil. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come into the light. But whoever does what is true comes to the light. Lord Jesus, through your agony and sweat, scourging and suffering, piercing and death, you take away the sins of the world. Lead us to the cross, where with repentant hearts we may humbly receive the gifts of your redeeming love. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated for the reading of the Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ. Hear now the Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John. When Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley, where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas, having procured a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him, came forward and said to them, "Whom do you seek?" They answered him, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus said to him, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. So he asked them again, "Whom do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered them, "I told you that I am here. So if you seek me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "Of those whom you gave me, I have lost not one." Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. So Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me?"
Thank you.
So the band of soldiers and their captain and the officers of the Jews arrested Jesus and bound him. First they led him to Annas, for he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had advised the Jews that it would be expedient that one man should die for the people. Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he entered with Jesus into the court of the high priest, but Peter stood outside at the door. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out and spoke to the servant girl who kept watch at the door and brought Peter in. The servant girl at the door said to Peter, "You also are not one of this man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Now the servants and officers had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing and warming themselves. Peter also was with them, standing and warming himself. The high priest then questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. Jesus answered him, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who have heard me what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said these things, one of the officers standing by struck Jesus with his hand, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered him, "If what I said is wrong, bear witness about the wrong. But if what I said is right, why do you strike me?" Annas then sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. So they said to him, "Are you not one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the servants of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Peter again denied it, and at once a rooster crowed. Please stand for prayer. Holy Father, forgive, heal, strengthen, and guide your church. Grant that it preaches always and only Christ crucified and raised from the dead for the forgiveness of sins unto everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive those who distort and dilute your holy word of law and gospel. Fill them with a renewed love for you and your Son, who is the way, the truth, and the life of the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive those who deny the reality of sin, or who focus only on selected sins of others. Lift their eyes to the one who was bruised for their iniquities. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive those who despise you and sneer at all who love you. Lead them to the foot of the cross of Christ, that they may learn the joys of repentance and humble faith. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive this congregation when we prefer anything whatsoever to your dear Son. Kindle our hearts with his holy love, so that when our neighbors see us, they may more clearly see him. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive our local, regional, and national church bodies when anything overshadows the proclamation of the gospel. Keep their hearts firmly fixed on Jesus, their Master and Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive our earthly leaders when they seek their own ends, not your will, when they engage in distracting rhetoric rather than serving the people. Forgive our military, police, and all others who ensure our safety when they overstep the limits of justice. Guide them in right pathways and bring clarity and integrity to all they do. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive and heal those who are sick, injured, angry, defiant, proud, despairing, frightened, or grieving. Give them faith to look upon the one who bore their sickness and grief, who carried their wounds and their sorrow, and upon whom was the chastisement that makes them whole. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us when we grieve as those without hope, when we think without wisdom, speak without mercy, and act without charity. Set before us the cross of Christ, and so lead us through the temptations and sorrows of this life. By the merits of your beloved Son, cleanse, heal, restore, and raise us from the realm of sin and death into the glorious light and endless joy of the kingdom he has won for all whom he is pleased to redeem. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear and graciously answer our prayers as you deem best for us, dear Father, for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Then they led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to the governor's headquarters. It was early morning. They themselves did not enter the governor's headquarters so that they would not be defiled, but could eat the Passover. So Pilate went outside to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered him, "If this man were not doing evil, we would not have delivered him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." The Jews said to him, "It is not lawful for us to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill the word that Jesus had spoken to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So Pilate entered his headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" Pilate answered, "Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting, that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from the world." Then Pilate said to him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice." Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went back outside to the Jews and told them, "I find no guilt in him. But you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. So do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" They cried out again, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a robber. Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him. And the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, "See, I am bringing him out to you that you may know that I find no guilt in him." So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Behold, the man." When the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no guilt in him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he has made himself the Son of God." When Pilate heard this statement, he was even more afraid. He entered his headquarters again and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. So Pilate said to him, "You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have authority to release you and authority to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me over to you has the greater sin." From then on, Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar." So when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the Stone Pavement, and in Aramaic, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the Jews, "Behold, your king." They cried out, "Away with him, away with him, crucify him." Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." So he delivered him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and he went out, bearing his own cross, to the place called of a skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. Pilate also wrote an inscription and put it on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Aramaic, in Latin, and in Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write, 'The King of the Jews,' but rather, 'This man said, I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and divided them into four parts, one part for each soldier, also his tunic. But the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it shall be." This was to fulfill the scripture, which says, "They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." So the soldiers did these things.
Thank you.
Let us stand for prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scripture, "I thirst." A jar full of sour wine stood there. So they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. You have been bought with a price. price paid not in gold or silver, but with the holy, innocent blood of our Redeemer. On this Good Friday, we stare at the cross. But the cross is such an odd thing for us to gather round. We treat it like a banner, a totem, a symbol of triumph. Yet it is, in its essence, an instrument of gruesome torture and agonizing death. It is, in all honesty, an odd thing to wear around your neck as jewelry, or to hang on our walls as decoration, or to slap on your car as a bumper sticker. We don't do that with other forms of capital punishment. I've never seen someone with a tattoo of a lethal injection needle or a woman wearing electric chair earrings. But this strange tradition of Christianity goes hand in hand with how we call this day Good Friday. This day doesn't seem particularly good. If there was one day a year we would choose to call good in the Christian faith, it seems like an odd choice to pick the worst, most painful day our Lord ever had. Good Christmas? Good Easter? Good water into wine day, even? Those good days make natural sense. But good murder Jesus day doesn't. Just seems like an interesting choice. And it's not like that name goes back to the very early church or anything. I mean, certainly the church has been remembering and celebrating the events of Christ's crucifixion on the Friday before Easter since very early on. But giving it the name Good Friday is not nearly as old. The first reference we have to a name suggestive of Good Friday is as late as the 13th century. So we should ask ourselves, why do we name this day Good Friday? Why do we reverence the cross, the very thing used to murder our Lord? Why do we celebrate the painful execution of Jesus? Are we Christians just macabre like that? Maybe a little. I'll admit, I love Good Friday. I love this Tenebrae service of darkness and shadow. I'd be lying if I said that this somber, contemplative, reflective, brooding service didn't appeal to my inner monk who revels in this worship service each year. But I don't love this service because I'm a big fan of executions or something. We as a church don't celebrate Good Friday because we enjoy the fact that this is the day Jesus died. That's not the point. That's not why we call it good. We recognize what the cross is. We must for it to retain any meaning. We acknowledge that the cross is death. We just understand that death. We know the history of that death. For Christ's death was not an accident. It wasn't just a mere tragedy. Christ's death was a sacrifice. Something occurred to me the other day that we don't often put into these terms. The cross was, in essence, a narrow wooden altar upon which Jesus of Nazareth offered the final Passover sacrifice. We don't really talk about the cross being an altar, but it was. It was the most important altar ever constructed upon which the most important sacrifice was ever offered. This very cross-shaped altar, which was used to inflict pain and death upon our Savior, has become to us a symbol of salvation, because that which was sacrificed on an altar was sacrificed for a reason. The blood of a sacrifice was shed to be the propitiation, the act which appeases God's wrath at sin. And while the blood of so many beasts had been shed over the years on the altar of the temple, this holy blood of God himself was shed on the altar of the cross as a sacrifice to end all sacrifices. How can this be? Well, what we know as Christians is that the power of the cross lies not in the wooden beams or the iron nails. The power of the cross is not in the death that it brings. The power of the cross is from the one who hung upon it. The power of the cross is life. So let's recount the story of that faithful day when the Lamb of God shed his blood on the narrow altar of Golgotha. Now, there are so many curious things to note about this tragic story of Jesus' death. The trial before Pilate was an absolute sham of a court because so many Roman and Jewish laws were broken in the process. For instance, it began in the dark of night, while Sanhedrin law required that all parts of the criminal proceedings, including the arrest, must occur within the light of the day. These things were supposed to happen out in the open, not under the cover of darkness. Jesus was convicted by a single judge, while typically a jury of three was required. The Sanhedrin law also required that if a guilty verdict in a capital case was to be given, it must happen on the following day. It was their way of sleeping on it before a person was sentenced to be executed. None of this was followed in Jesus' case. Ironically, if Jesus was to be executed for violating Jewish law, he wouldn't even have been crucified. He would have been stoned to death. That was the Jewish method of capital punishment. Convicted criminals were brought to a pit at the edge of the city, pushed down into it, and then stones were hurled at them until they stopped moving. And as atrocious as this sounds, in truth, it was a more humane practice than the Roman way, since death came quickly. Roman crucifixion was, by design, much more drawn out, much more painful. When a man was crucified, he was first stripped of his clothing and beaten. A cat of nine tails, a whip of leather with pieces of sharp glass or stones at the end of it, was used across the back. 39 lashes were administered because it is commonly believed that 40 lashes would kill a man. So 39 it was, because they didn't want him to die early. They wanted to watch him die on the cross. He was laid across a timber on the ground, and nails, sometimes up to 9 inches in length, were driven through his wrists. His feet were crossed, and a single nail pierced them. When the cross was uprighted and dropped into a hole, the flesh would often tear. And then the dying began. It took sometimes days for the criminal to breathe his last. For a while, they could boost themselves up with their arms and their legs. But as fatigue set in, their weary bodies slouched, their chest muscles caved in, and the windpipe closed. They became too exhausted to breathe. That's the big secret of crucifixion. You tend to think it's the nails that kill, the blood loss, the agony. No, in the end, a death by crucifixion was a death of suffocation. Surrounded by air, you are unable to lift your chest up to breathe. It was the most horrible form of execution the Romans could devise, reserved only for the worst of the worst and never for Roman citizens themselves. This is what our Lord suffered for us. Jesus was crucified somewhere around 9 a.m. About noon, Luke tells us that the sky went dark. Not just that the sun was shaded by cloud or that the moon partially eclipsed the sun. The entire land went dark. And not just for 3 minutes, like we will experience in a week or so's time, but for 3 full hours. From noon to 3, the sun's light simply failed. darkness came over the land in more ways than one. Then around 3 p.m., Jesus cries out in a loud voice and gives up his spirit. At this moment, the temple curtain, which blocked off the most holy place where God's presence would dwell, spontaneously tore from top to bottom. This 4-inch thick curtain, acting as a wall between God and man, no longer separated the two, now that Christ's blood had been shed for the redemption of all mankind. The earth shakes, rocks split, tombs were opened, and dead saints rise from the grave. A man, likely a Pharisee and possibly a secret follower of Christ by the name of Joseph, a wealthy man from Arimathea, received permission from Pilate to take Jesus' expired body down from the cross. The Jewish Sabbath was about to begin at sundown, and work could not be done on the Sabbath. If Jesus' body was not taken down now, it would remain on the cross until Saturday sundown. Joseph wanted to remove Jesus' body respectfully as soon as possible. Scripture then says that Joseph of Arimathea placed him in his own burial tomb. A large stone was rolled in front of the entrance of the grave, not only to close the grave, but also to assure that none could steal Jesus' body and proclaim that the resurrection he had foretold had come true. The resounding boom of the stone rolling into place at the tomb rang out, echoing the finality of Jesus' death. It is finished. For now. Yes, for now. Because we know that the story does not end here. Not in this grave. Not under the weight of that closing sepulchral stone. Even as the echoes of its resounding boom faded into silence, another sound was preparing to rise. A sound of victory and triumph. A sound of dawn amidst this night's darkness. But for now, we must wait for that morning light. For now, take this time to examine what the shadows of this Tenebrae service mean. Accept the fact that Jesus hangs on the cross for you as a result of your sin. And yes, that's awful. That is our sin and shame. But this is not Sin and Shame Friday. This is Good Friday. Because through his dying, he has made a sacrifice on our behalf. Placed himself on this altar cross out of his love for us. So find the light amidst the Tenebrae shadows. Find the promises found in the silence. And discover why this darkest of Fridays is not good, but great. For it was on this day, this terrible, terrible, and wonderful day, that the power of sin was finally broken. The chains that bound us to death and decay were shattered by the very one who had been bound and beaten. Through his blood we have been forgiven, and in his death we will find life. Amidst the stillness of this night, as we leave with the echo of the tomb's closure ringing in our ears, let it not signal despair, but be heard as a prelude to resurrection. This Good Friday, full of mourning, whispers secrets of a victory so triumphant it rends the veil between heaven and earth. In darkness, let us find the strength to await the light of Easter. Let us this day, marked by tears and tribulation, etch into our souls the portrait of a love so potent, it reaches into the very heart of darkness to bring forth a new dawn. our Lord will return. Just wait. Amen. Since it was the day of preparation, and so that the bodies would not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, that you also may believe. For these things took place that the scripture might be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And again, another scripture says, they will look on him whom they have pierced. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took away his body. Nicodemus also, who earlier had come to Jesus by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds in weight. So they took the body of Jesus and bound it in linen cloths with the spices, as the burial custom of the Jews. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, since the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there.